Legal Live is brought to you by Farah and Farah.
The comments and opinions expressed on this radio program do not constitute legal advice and do not create an attorney-client relationship. If you have a legal problem, a formal consultation will be required outside of this radio program.
This is Legal Live with Eddie and Chuck Farah. They're talking the latest legal news and answering your questions. To call Legal Live and ask Eddie and Chuck a question, grab your phone and dial 855-765-1045. That's 855-765-1045.
Legal Live, brought to you by Farah and Farah on 104.5 WOKV, Jacksonville's news and talk. We want your calls, so give us a call at 855-765-1045. I'm Benjamin Fritkus, and I'm sitting in for Shefalika today. I'm joined today by Eddie and Chuck Farah. How's it going today, gentlemen?
It's all good, Benjamin. Thanks for chipping in today.
Yeah, of course. It's
my
pleasure.
We need all the help we can get. But let me tell you, right, it's the last show of the year for us.
Yeah.
And I tell you, we've been cruising for about 15, I forgot how long we've been doing it, Chuck, 15, 20 years?
Yeah, I'm
it gets
just
better
looking
every,
forward.
It gets better every back. Saturday, you know.
Goodness gracious.
Yeah, we got a lot to talk about, though. You know, your phone calls are so important. We take, those are our priority. But you know what? And we're PI lawyers, you know. We had a lot of, as you know, what we do. But we want to take calls and questions from everybody about any legal subject because it's interesting to us. I mean, the most interesting stuff we do, the coolest stuff we do, really, is coming from the callers. Not topics we come up to talk about. It's people calling in with their legal questions or their concerns. And, I mean, every week it's different.
Yeah, it's the twists and turns in life that
the
they
same.
Bring to this show, you know, and it makes it interesting.
Yeah.
Oh,
so
yeah.
Their personal twists and turns.
People make it. That's why we call it Legal Live, Chuck.
Yeah.
Live if you want it.
Live if you love it, yeah.
Live if you want
it. Love you live, you know.
Okay, and love you live. Don't love the opposite.
I think we're getting
it. It sure beats the opposite. Okay, but anyway. Okay, all right. So I'm going to talk about credit, you know, these credit companies. You know, these credit, you can see them on television. They advertise, hey, give us some money. We can improve your credit scores. You know, I did have sort of a deep dive on this thing because it's really, I always see those advertisements. I wonder, how do they do it? If I got a bad, listen, if I'm not paying my bills and my credit score is in the tank, how can they fix that? You know, I mean, I always wonder what were their antics, you know, what's going on? But there is a way to fix it, you know, temporarily, but it fixes it. And you can, really, you can do it on your own. You don't even need one of these companies to do it. But anyway, there are three major, just to give you some background, there are three major companies that deal with your credit scores: Equifax, Experium, and TransUnion. And these are the big three. They control the credit market, and they sell that information to the banks because the bank's got to have it. Before you get a car loan, before you get a mortgage, the bank has to rely on that information so they can determine if they're going to give you the loan and whether or not they're going to give you a good interest rate or a higher interest rate because your credit's in the tank, okay? These credit scores have always baffled me, Benjamin. I don't know about you. I know friends of mine who are drowning in money, and they got like a 400 credit score. Then I know some guy, I know a guy who's just living paycheck to paycheck. He tells me it's like 750. Mm-hmm. So it's always been sort of opaque and confusing to me anyway.
Okay.
I mean, you probably heard stories of people who don't have a nickel to their name and their credit score is 800 or something. But
yeah. I mean, once you fall into the hole, it's hard to get out, but it feels like you kind of need a little bit of money to get into that hole in the first place. Is that right?
Yeah, I think I think he just summed up the whole article, man. but even though you summed it up, I'm going to still talk about it.
Oh, yeah, of course.
Okay. But anyway, so, you know, what the government got involved because people were talking about identity theft. Oh, man, they filed, I'm a victim of identity theft. They're taking my credit's been ruined. So the government stepped in and said they made it easier to file claims for identity theft. So you go to the website, it's identitytheft.gov, and you file your complaint that, hey, I'm a victim of identity theft. These people got to my Social Security card. They ran up some credit cards, whatever happened. And then what happens at that point is that the information, all the bad information, has to be removed while the company investigates it. So you file your claim on identitytheft.gov, tell them that my identity has been stolen. Here's where I'm getting to right now, where the scams come in, because you've got people who are reporting identity theft when there has been no identity theft. And so what that does, that gives you a window. It's called credit washing. They have to take down all the negative stuff while they're investigating the information. And it's during that period of time that people do slick things, because they can go apply for credit now. They've got a clean slate. They can go get credit cards. They can apply for car loans. They can apply for mortgages. So there's a gap of time that when you file your claim, whether you file your complaint, whether it's legit or not, and this is where these credit companies come in. There's a company out of Florida, based in Florida, that is sort of the main culprit that will promise to clean up your credit. And what they're basically doing is filing false identity theft claims through the website. Jesus. And they're called that credit washing. And they're giving you, and they'll send you a report saying, hey, I mean, it's only for a 4-day gap or maybe for a week or two, but look at your credit now, even though it reverts back to the way it was once they find out what's going on.
Gotcha.
Yeah, like Experian, for instance, they advertise improve your score instantly. So as soon as you sign up, it's improved. I don't know how I'm looking at this.
Yeah.
And I don't know if they're filing false identity theft claims, but
The reason they win it, I mean, listen, what's bad? I mean, you know, in Florida, you can be in let's say you're in a car accident. You got 4 years to file a statute of limitations to file a lawsuit. If you've got any kind of negative information on your credit report, it's one late payment reported, that's on your credit for 7 years. That's really amazing. Mm-hmm. That's why these banks, I mean, don't get me started on the banks. I'm going to talk about the banks in a minute, but how they're scamming people on these overdraft charges. But the banks require, I mean, they can go back 7 years. I mean, a lot happens in 7 years. You're late on a payment 7 years ago, really have anything to do with the way you're doing economically now. It could be in a whole different situation.
Yeah, you would think they'd average it out or something, you know, to, you know, not just, you know, ding you for that one little mishap. But
I mean, I've got people that I'm living with. I've got guys that I've known who will swap, you know, 7 cars in 7 years, or do all kinds of crazy things with their credit, or do these trades. And who knows?
According to this article, 80-90% of all identity theft claims are false. People just do them to clean up their credit temporarily, to get that little gap, that credit washing period, where they can now go and apply for more credit cards or get credit while their credit's being investigated. But, you know, it used to be, until 2016, if you were a victim of identity theft, you had to file a police report, which puts you in kind of a bad way, because, you know, that's filing a false report. Mm-hmm. That's a felony. I mean, you go to jail for that. So the government removed that requirement that you have to file that police report. So you don't need to file a police report. You can just go to identitytheft.gov and file your identity theft complaint.
I gotcha. Right?
Okay.
And I would love to get back into that some more, but I see that we do have Paul and Bill on the line. Paul, you've been waiting very patiently, and we will take your call as soon as we are finished up with this upcoming break. Take us home. Welcome back to Legal Live, brought to you by Farah and Farah on 104.5 WOKV, Jacksonville's News and Talk. You can give us a call at 855-765-1045. I'm Ben, and I'm joined by Eddie and Chuck. And we had a data point we wanted to clear up.
Yes, I just want to clarify one little piece of information I talked about earlier. When I talked about filing a complaint with identitytheft.gov, once you file the complaint, and they have 4 days to take down all the information that you had or concerned about. So it's really, this is what we call, again, credit washing, where you can go in and they have to remove the negative stuff that you complained about within 4 days. And that's where people, and we kind of talked about, Benjamin, how people are using that to their advantage. And that's why the banks now are not really excited about looking at these credit scores, because they know that people can play with them and that they can be manipulated and they can be dealt with. So the banks now are trying to find other ways to rate people so they can give them loans. And so we'll see what happens. But, you know, I'll tell you, the one of the main culprits of this credit scam thing going on is a company here in Florida. And they're involved in a big lawsuit with the federal government right now because of them doing some supposedly shady things and trying to improve people's credit. But according to this article I read, most of the stuff that these people advertise they can do for you, you can do it on your own. So anyway, that's that. But
well, that's certainly interesting. You know, and that's stuff that I certainly didn't know. But we have a caller on the line. So we've got Bill in Mandarin. You have a question about a car accident. Tell us more about that, please.
Yeah, hey, guys. Hey, always a pleasure to listen to y'all.
Thanks, man.
Thanks for calling, Bill.
All right. Hey, yeah, so one of my work trucks got rear-ended, and the other party took fault, and the insurance company is going through it. Well, they told me my van and my work van, and, you know, I've only got four trucks from a small company, and with that truck off the road, I had two men that I didn't have anybody to, you know, anywhere for the guys to go. I mean, I was driving around in my SUV, getting them to job sites and trying to make it work so they could get their hours in, and it just wasn't available with that truck not being on the road anymore.
Right, you're saying you lose an income. You lose an income.
Sure.
Yeah, it's not just the value.
Yeah, so we went.
Yeah, go ahead.
No, I was going to say, so we went from like October 10th when it happened to now, and they just told it about a week ago. And, I mean, they gave me a crappy SUV for not a crappy one, but I mean, an SUV that I can't work out of, you know what I mean? And, we lost so much money and I ended up getting two employees and, they quit on me because they weren't enough hours.
Wow.
Okay.
And you know how hard it is to get employees, especially good ones.
Oh yeah.
It's hard to get anybody to work these days. You're right.
Agreed.
Okay, well, the thing about it is, I don't know why it took them so long. They should have gotten you. They're required to give you while they're totaling it out. I don't know why it took that long to total it out. Usually they total it out within a week. You know, I don't know, something's going on. I mean, you probably have a claim.
What it is
what?
Why did it take so long? Man, where you shelve it.
Yeah, but.
But because the collision center were bucket heads, okay? They just told the bumper. I mean, they said first it was a bumper and two doors, $2,800. And then I was like, well, look at the shelves. I got $5,000 worth of work shelves in here that got yanked right out of the inner skin. And I brought that to the attention right at the beginning anyways, but they still gave me that $2,800 settlement. And I was like, no, I said, I got shelves that were just yanked out of the walls. All the inner skin's gone. You can't reattach that stuff. And then that's where everything started going slow. And then after, you know, 2 months, they finally said, all right.
Okay, so total.
It's total.
Okay. Yeah, did you already accept the money and sign a release?
No.
Okay.
No.
Yeah.
Do you know what the coverage is on the other party that rear-ended? Do you know have any idea of that? Who are you?
No.
I don't know if we want to mention any insurance companies. Yeah, I mean.
Well, it's one of the big ones.
One of the big ones. Okay.
How much property damage coverage? Do they have enough money under their policy to pay you the fair market value of the truck and everything that was damaged in it,
the shells and all that? I think the lost profits would come under that.
Well, I think because of their delay, the way they jacked them around, well, bad faith. I think it's bad faith. But
then there's diminished value, I would imagine.
Well, there's not diminished value unless they repair it.
That's right.
Remember, diminished value only comes into play if your car can be repaired. It's worth less because it's been hit. But a total loss, I owe you the sales tax. Make sure you get the sales tax. And on top of that, I would demand 2 months worth of loss of use, which is the fact you didn't have your van for that two-month period. Whatever it costs to rent a van, like the one you had, it could be $500 a day. Then you can demand that also. I just don't know how much property damage coverage they have. I mean, they're supposed to give that to you if you request it in writing. You should ask them how much coverage do you have for property damage. That's where you start.
Okay. Hey, now a law firm like you guys probably don't handle that because you guys specialize in so many other things. But who would I go to if the insurance just guy says, no, we're not giving you that, we're not giving you this, you're not getting that?
Well, you haven't
who do you talk to?
Well, I mean, they haven't said no yet. I mean,
listen, you first start with requesting their policy limits. Find out what's available under the insurance. Was this an individual owner that rear-ended your truck, your van?
No, it was a company. It was a landscaping pest control company.
That rear-ended you.
So they probably have good coverage on that.
Yeah, so they may have business coverage, liability coverage that may apply. I mean, yeah.
Well, they got property damage. You want to find out how much property damage coverage they have. They got 30, because in Florida, all you're required is to have 10 grand. You know, that's not much. So if they have 30 or 40,000, you could claim the fair market value of the vehicle, of course, what it was worth with all the stuff in it, because that stuff, that aftermarket stuff costs money. Anything that was damaged, tools, anything, cell phones, glasses, like Chuck said on that commercial right before the break.
Yeah, I heard that. Yeah.
Claim everything. So dancing hula girls, whatever you want to claim. All that comes into play. And
that's how you become whole, though. I mean, that's what
exactly.
You have.
That's the whole idea of the spot. But anyway, so for 2 months, you didn't have that van, and the one they gave you was inadequate. They owe you the money for that van. If it was $500 a day to go out and get one from some specialty real company. Because we represent people, and we see this in motorcycle accidents all the time. My guys have been in a really nice motorcycle. They try to give them some little moped, you know, to drive around. It doesn't work.
Well, in this case, it really doesn't work because he's losing profits for not having a van similar to
He
had.
Yeah, exactly. So you got a lot to work with.
I lost 2 men during that time.
Exactly. I know that you can get that, but you can claim the rental value and the fair market value of the vehicle and what it would cost to have a van. Because you can claim I wouldn't have lost them if I had a van that would work, you know?
Yep.
But there may be other coverages that would cover lost profits and other things.
You got to, like Chuck says, you got to get the policy first.
Yep.
And then you got to have somebody look at it. You could probably come by our office. I'll look at it for you. We'll look at it.
Yeah, we'll look at the policy.
We'll look at it for you and tell you what it says.
Okay. Okay. So you guys think there's All right. So request what from the insurance company?
Copy the insurance policy. The covered this accident.
A copy of the policy.
Send me a copy of the coverages. Like what kind of money they got available for this thing?
Yeah.
And then you take it from
there. I got to do that in writing via email.
Right. Yeah.
You can do it by email.
Typically. Yeah. And they got 30 days to give it to you under Florida.
Excellent. Okay. All right, guys. Hey, and so is this something that you guys would be interested in give me a little help on besides just a quick look over, or is there another law firm that I would?
I don't know of anyone, Bill. I mean, I would look at it because we deal in personal injury. Most people that I know deal with personal injury. Now, what you could do, if you really feel I don't know what your damages are. If your damages are in the thousands of dollars.
Oh, every day. An electrical contractor's truck brings in $2,500 to $5,000 a day.
Then you're talking real money. You're talking real money. Now, I may be able to find you. When you're talking about that kind of money, I may be able to find you somebody to handle it.
Yeah, so what you do is get the policy, then come to us, and then we'll go from there. Okay. I think that's the best move.
And in the meantime, I'll make some calls. I think I know somebody that can help you. And as a matter of fact, why don't you leave your number? Okay, I know somebody that may be able. I got two guys that may be able to help you out.
Excellent.
Leave your phone number and I'll call you. Well, Monday I may not be. Maybe Tuesday. Just leave your number, or I'll be in touch next week, and I'll give you a name and a phone number.
Always appreciate you guys. Right. Thanks again.
Yeah, man. Thanks for that's good. See, this is what I'm talking about, Benjamin. Mm-hmm. The calls we get, you know,
the twists and turns.
I mean, this is probably the first time. We've had people call in about their truck and their vehicles and all that. But here's a guy who's got a legitimate business that this truck is making him money. I mean, this truck is everything. You know, they jack him around for 2 months. And they finally, this is what the insurance companies are. They finally come around, okay, it's a total loss. It can't be repaired. He's lost everything at that point. He lost 2 employees. He lost a couple of grand a day.
He may have a business loss policy that he could tap into.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, I mean, covered himself
This is how they try to wear you down, you know. I'm glad Bill hung in there, and they haven't heard the last from Bill. We're going to help him out.
Oh, yeah. He's going to bring it back to him.
Yes, sir.
How do you even quantify losing 2 employees in your business?
Yeah.
It's simply amazing to me. But
the insurance company doesn't care, and they're trying to get him to take $2,800 on a repair. You know, they threw some chump change at him, thinking he would jump on it. But no, he hung in there, and he showed it was a total loss. And now they got to pay him that. Bill, make sure you get the sales tax on whatever the fair market value is of that vehicle.
All right. Well, that's all the time we have for this segment. You are listening to Legal Live on 104.5 WOKV, Jacksonville's News and Talk. We still want to hear from you, so give us a call at 855-765-1045. We're going to be right back after this quick break. And thanks again, Bill. All right. right. Welcome back to Legal Live, brought to you by Farah and Farah on 104.5 WOKV, Jacksonville's News and Talk. Give us a call at 855-765-1045. I'm Ben, and I'm joined by Eddie and Chuck. And we've got Paul on the west side. Says here you've got a you have a question about a contractor being required to have insurance. Tell us more about that.
Hey, Paul.
Hey, I appreciate you guys.
Yeah, man.
I'm just an independent contractor. Got a little business. I do window repair, and I've got a property management company that asked me to do some stuff for them, which I'm happy to do. And of course, they want to put me on their vendor list, and they ask for all of my information and everything. And I understand when they ask me to be as an added insured on my liability coverage. But then they asked to be additional assured on my auto coverage. And I thought, what are they afraid? I'm going to run over somebody? Or is that normal?
You're an independent contractor. They really don't have any respect. If you cause an accident in your vehicle and you're working for them and you truly are an independent contractor, they don't have any responsibility. Why would you want to, why would they require you to put them on your car insurance? That doesn't make sense.
That's what I figured. No, it doesn't. And, I don't have even any, it doesn't make any sense, so I didn't want to do it, but I didn't know whether that was something that was normal or not.
No, it's not normal. I've never heard of such a thing. I mean, it's like me telling my yard guy, my landscaping company, oh, you're cutting my grass every week? Then you put me as an insured under your car insurance policy. It doesn't make any sense.
No.
Yeah.
It doesn't do it. I don't know why they're making you do that. These guys don't know what they're talking about.
Yeah, right.
I don't know who you're dealing with, but that's an unnecessary expense, because to add them to the policy, that's gonna make your rates crazy, because they're gonna have to go underwrite that company that you're dealing with.
Well, I didn't even ask my insurance company about it. I just said, gee, if you want your windows fixed. So anyway, we still haven't gotten to the bottom of that yet.
Yeah.
I have one other question.
Yeah. Go ahead.
I had just a minor traffic accident. It wasn't my fault. Other party was at fault. The insurance company fessed up and everything. But I had an older truck.
Right.
And it did damage to the truck, and nobody could fix it because you can't get parts for it.
Right.
So they sent me a check for $1,600, which I told them wasn't enough. I wasn't asking for a lot. I told them that the accident, I had just gotten new tires, and they're all flat spotted now. So they sent me a check. I never cashed it. When I check back with them, they say, oh, the thing is closed.
How many years has it been?
It's just since April.
You can refile. Yeah. You got 4-year statute of limitations. You got 4 years to file a lawsuit. So your claim is
consistent. You can send them the check back.
Send them the check back. Reclaim. Start a new claim. So listen, here it is. I mean, close means nothing. This is how they operate. Yeah. It'll mean that close means after 4 years it's closed. Yeah, but if it ain't, if your lawsuit has been filed or you're within the 4 years, you can have at it.
Okay. All right. I think I'm gonna have my insurance company look after it. And is that a good idea?
Well, what's gonna happen if your insurance company pays you for the truck? You're going to give up your right. You're going to give up your right to go against them, because your insurance company then goes against those guys that caused the accident to get their money back. That's called subrogation. So if you accept a check from your insurance company, you're giving up your right to file against the company that caused the accident.
Okay. Well, I'm not asking for a whole lot more, but if they gave me what I was asking for, I'd be happy to do that.
Well, you can still open it back up again. And what you would do, I would do an internet. What I used to tell people, what we would do, we would get an internet search. We would go look for a typical vehicle like that, no matter how old it was. I'd go on cars.com or any of those websites, Auto Trader, and try to find a like vehicle and say, look, they're going for it, because they have to pay you the retail value. Not the wholesale value. They got to pay you what it costs for you to buy that truck on a lot. And they have to pay you the sales tax. So if it's $2,000, they owe you 7% sales tax on top of it. So it's not just the value, but just the retail value of the vehicle, not the wholesale.
It didn't total it. It just didn't, it just did damage for parts.
I know, but in their mind, didn't they total it?
Yeah.
No, they didn't total it. They just sent me a check for $1,600 and hoped I'd go away.
Okay. Well, I mean,
you
still have
sure
the truck.
Are you sure it's not totaled?
Well, he'd have to give them the title. Are they going to ask for the if they pay you what you want for the truck, let's say it's $3,000, are you going to have to give up the title to that truck and give it to them?
Well, I wouldn't do it.
Well, I mean, then you won't get the $3,000. I mean, what they'll do is if they total it, they give you a check, you sign the title over to them, and then they go sell it for salvage. And that's what's going to happen. Right. Now, maybe you can work out a special deal with them. I'll keep the truck, give me $1,600 and some sales tax, and I'll just leave you alone. I'll keep my truck, and I got my $1,600. But a lot of times...
Yeah, what I'm looking for is more like $2,500 or $2,100 or something like
that. You can ask them.
More than what I got.
Okay, well, maybe they'll pay you that and let you keep the truck.
But the way you have to do that is you have to substantiate why you want more money. You've got to give them data. Remember, insurance companies will pay if you can show them that they need to pay. And that means, you know, you may have added something to that truck recently that adds value to it. You may put new tires on it. You may have had an overhaul of some sort to the truck. But you have to give them some sort of basis to pay you more money.
Have you given them, or have you done an internet search to see what that truck goes for? Have you went online?
Oh, yeah. I mean, it'd be probably a $5,000 truck if you could find one.
Okay, well, then, so that's the point. You got to find one and show it to them. You know, I mean, that's the whole idea, if you could find one, which means there's not one out there for $5,000.
You said it was an older truck, correct?
Well, still, you can find values. Mm-hmm. Listen, on the internet, you can find anything.
It's true.
So you go find a truck, a typical truck like that, for that price. You go, look, here's one for sale in Colorado for $5,000. Why are you offering me $2,100 or $19 or $16, whatever it is? That's how you, Chuck says, you got to substantiate why you're asking for more money. Because these guys, these insurance adjusters, they got to report to their supervisor. You think they have control of the money? They don't have control. The computer has control of the money. The computer tells them what to do. If they put the right data in the computer, you'll get your check for $2,500. Otherwise, you're going to be pounding sand.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, I appreciate it. You guys are awesome. Yeah. And I can't wait till you can talk Dahlia and Khalid.
Khalil,
Khalil,
man, it's hard to get these young kids. It's hard to get these young kids to work
on
the
social lives too.
You know that. I mean, I beg them. You know how it is. They got these.
this is what we have. This is our social life.
This is all we have. That's all we got left.
We're talking to you guys.
This is our social life.
We don't want to take over because we miss you guys. There ain't nobody like you.
Yeah, you try to get these kids to work on the weekend, they head for the hills.
Yeah, they're talking about going to another firm or something.
We'll work for the competitor.
All right, well, thanks for hanging in there, guys.
All right, man. Yeah, thanks for calling in. That's a good question. That's another good question, I'm telling you.
Yeah, because
Benjamin.
Let me clarify something. Hold on. If you got an older truck... And typically, if the damages to the truck equal to 80% or more of the value of that truck, then it's total. So you may have a whole truck that may, you know, you may have a part that, you know.
But they can't find that part. So they cost so much money.
They probably totaled this truck out, and they're offering them $1,600.
Well, and let them keep it.
And let him keep it.
Now, if they give him $5,000, they may say, okay, we want the truck back. We want to go sell the salvage.
Right.
So he may be better off just taking it.
Yeah.
Taking the money and run. He still got his truck.
Yes. Well, it is certainly interesting. I'm learning so much from you guys today. I need to check in more often, Lord Benjamin, Almighty.
You're welcome anytime to listen in. It's 12 to 1 on Saturdays.
I know. I'm very aware.
I mean.
Well, thank you so much for your call,
Paul. Plus, you can go online. You can listen to the past shows, too, if you want to.
That's true. I had to do that to prepare for this one.
That's pretty low down if you're...
Talking about a social life.
Gotta do what you gotta do. Hey, you're listening to Legal Live on 104.5 WOKV, Jacksonville's News and Talk. We'd love to hear from you, so give us a call at 855-765-1045. You can be on just like Paul was. We're gonna be right back after this quick break. Welcome back to Legal Live, brought to you by Farah and Farah on 104.5 WOKV, Jacksonville's News and Talk. You can give us a call at 855-765-1045. I'm Ben, and I'm joined by Eddie and Chuck, and we've got a caller on the line, Pat from Jacksonville. You have a property issue. How you doing?
Well, good afternoon, fellas. How y'all doing?
Hey, holding up, Pat. How you doing?
Oh, doing well. My question is about, as everybody who owns a piece of property knows, they get these offers for, you want to buy your place.
Right, right.
I just got one from some people that, you know, an as-is
right.
Offer to. Now, I was just wondering, now that's kind of interesting to me because I've got significant things to do with my property and looking to move. Okay. Now, have you, I guess some people are nefarious about what, you know, what they're going to do. Have you heard any claims or issues with some of these
money.
People?
The money. Yeah, we had a caller.
We had a caller that went through a situation where they ended up getting paid. They got paid. They were jacked. What they did, they bought it as is, but it just took them a longer time to get the money. They were concerned about, you know, because they weren't, it took like another couple of weeks before they got paid. So what you want to look at is the, you know, a lot of people don't, they'll tell you you don't need a lawyer, you don't need to spend money on a lawyer. Go spend a couple of hundred dollars with an attorney. Just let them look at the contract. It'll be the best money you ever spent. If they buy it as is, they're going to take it. Yeah. If there are holes in the floor, they buy it with holes in the floor, you know?
And do your research on the value, too, because, of course, they're going to try to undercut.
Yeah, that's why they're saying as is.
But, you know.
That's true.
So
that's what I was wondering. Because people,
you're breaking up. But the main thing is.
You got to have a lawyer look at everything.
This other guy didn't have a lawyer. They convinced him, you don't need a lawyer to pay you cash money and all that. And you don't have to pay. Don't why spend your money? $200 is well worth it. Go get somebody to look at the contract.
My concern would be about how, just how honestly that they would deal with,
Pat,
with a lawyer, you're going to make sure the money comes in.
They're in the business of making money.
Zillow in it. That's $1,000.
You're breaking up. I know you're talking about Zillow, but remember, this company is in the business of making money. They're not looking after your interests. No matter what they tell you, they're in it to make money for themselves. So you've got to have somebody on your side. Hire a lawyer. It's that way you can sleep at night.
Yeah, because the prior caller signed all the paperwork, and days went by before the money hit his bank.
Do you know why they were doing that, Pat? You know why they were doing that? They were flipping the house. They had him under contract, and they weren't even using their money. They were going to sell that house. They flipped it.
They didn't have the contract.
They had the money. They didn't pay for the car house yet. They were marketing the house.
Yeah.
They owned it. They were marketing the house before they paid him the money.
Yeah.
So, do you see what's going on?
I'll definitely find somebody who can talk with.
Yeah.
Yeah, a lawyer will make sure it all transacts the right way so that you're secured. It's worth it.
Very good.
Good luck.
That advice sounds pretty solid, dude.
Yeah.
I appreciate y'all so much.
Yeah, we learned what happened to the other guy.
Yep.
really?
They were out marketing his house before he got his money. They were trying to sell it again.
Yeah, they were trying to do a cashless transaction, basically, where nothing was out of their pocket.
Yeah. Okay.
Positively predatory.
We got to get moving. We got...
predatory is a good word
for
that.
Yeah.
Yeah, so we thank you so much for your call.
Yeah. Oh, no,
we've got a Susan next. Yeah. Susan in Jacksonville. Says here you're living in a mobile home and you have a question about your property taxes. What's going on there?
I live in a mobile home for 20 years now. It's not on my own land. I rent the lot. And 3 months ago, they started charging me property tax. I pay registration for double wide. That's why I don't have my own property, so I don't have to pay property tax. And suddenly, I'm now being charged lot rent and property tax, and I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, I know your question. We're kind of running a little short on time. I want to make sure we can answer it for you.
Go ahead.
Okay, Susan, it's very simple. Look at the lease. What's in the written lease you have with your landlord determines what you got to pay. A lot of landlords insert that in the lease that you're going to be responsible for the property taxes plus the rent. Because the way they justify it is, as property values go up, they got to pay more property tax, but your rent maybe stays the same. So it's money out of their pocket. So they're going to try to put the property tax on you. But it's got to be in writing.
They're new owners, yeah. And I don't have a lease with them.
Well, then you're month to month.
They never gave me one to sign.
Okay, then you got to go to them and find out and put it in writing. Because, well, they can say, if you don't want to pay the property tax, they can give you, 30 days to get out?
Yep. And if you don't move your mobile home, they keep it.
They keep you sound like a lawyer now.
I also have three tall trees in front of the home, and they're old, and I asked them to cut them down or do something because a branch fell on my roof, made a hole in my roof. I had to pay for a whole new roof. They came and cut off a couple of branches, but the trees are very old. They said it's my responsibility to cut them down. Well, again, it's not my property.
Well, you got to come to terms with, okay, whatever my rent is, I'm okay paying the rent and the property taxes. That's what you got to come to terms. And if you don't, you got to pick up and move. That's why you got snipes. You got a trailer. You can just take your house somewhere else. Mm-hmm. That's the whole.
Yeah, it would cost $15,000 to move it.
Is that what it costs to move?
My goodness.
Wow.
Yeah, for a double wide, yes.
Dang, 50. That's a lot. Yeah. Wow. I mean, that's where they got you. You got no choice. Let's pay the property taxes. You may go back to attorney negotiate and say, hey, well, you want to get something in writing because they may add some more fees onto it next year. I mean, is it?
Oh, I'm sure they will.
Well, that's why you want to probably get something in writing at least to where you can control what you're having to pay. At least you know what you're paying.
Okay. Thank you so much for your time.
Because see, what will happen?
And have a great day.
Yeah, have a nice holiday. Because if you don't have something in writing, you know, these mobile home parks are being sold to developers. They're coming in and offering them a bunch of money, and they're putting in houses and apartment complexes. At least if you have a written lease for 3 or 4 years, you can stay there for 3 or 4 years. So you've got some leverage, and you can stick around. But when you're month to month like you are, somebody else comes and buys this place.
You got a 30-day window.
And they can say, I'm going to double your rent. And if you can't pay it, then you got
to
go.
Yeah, that's all there is to it. Well, thank you so much for your call, Susan. We greatly appreciate you.
This show went fast today.
I feel like it always goes fast.
Yeah, man,
Well, thank you so much, everybody, for your calls. We had some amazing callers today, and thank you for listening to Legal Live.
Merry Christmas to everyone. See you at the first of the year.
Absolutely.
I think we're done until 2023, Ben.
That sounds really nice.
What are we going to do then?
I don't know, Saturday.
We got to be back next Saturday.
Yeah, but can we just come hang out here in the studio and act like we have a show?
You can hang out. I'm not going to be here, but you can hang out. That's for sure.
There'll be some football games we can watch on the TV or something.
They should be on. Hey, we're going to be back next Saturday at noon on 104.5 WOKV, Jacksonville's News and Talk. Thank you again so much.